praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Jesus. Lord Jesus, we love you so much. We thank you, Lord God, for your goodness. We thank you, Jesus. How great is our God. How mighty to save and to deliver us. Oh, Father, you truly are worthy of the praises of your people, from the rising of the sun to the setting of the same, and in the midnight hours, all through the night, all through the watches of the night, Lord, you are worthy of our praises, for you have done great things for us, whereof we are glad. You have done such great things for us, Father. You have done such great things for us. Great things. And we're so glad at what you've done. How can you be other than ecstatically excited for what he has done? And what he is going to do. Thank you, Jesus. Woo, glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm so excited about everything he is and everything he's done and everything that he is doing and everything that he's going to do in you, in me, through us. Simply because he is. And we said yes. We said yes. I don't think there's a person, I'm looking over every person in this place, and I don't think there's a person in here that hasn't said yes. There's not a person in this place, not one person in this place, I know, that wants to go live in misery of the powers of darkness and let Satan be their ruler or their taskmaster. You've said yes to Jesus. And I tell you what, he's got his eye on you, his hand on you. He said, you're mine. You are mine. You're mine. And he is pursuing after you. And the more you pursue after him, the explosion takes place. Oh, hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And he's able to fill you with his glory, the ever-increasing power of his anointing as we just surrender to him.
Hallelujah.
You know, the only reason people would be ineffective in the kingdom of God is they just haven't come to that knowledge of the truth of what he's done in us. He's done. People continue to try to help God out. And Paul said, oh, you foolish Galatians, why would you go back over there to your ability? The law. When I've finished the work. And he says in Galatians 2:20, he said, get this, and you say this. This, Paul says, this is Paul's declaration because this is the fact. And we should all say this again and again. I am crucified with Christ. I am crucified with Christ. When he was crucified, I took that on. And now I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I. But Christ lives in me.
Amen.
And the life that I now live, I live by the faith of the Son of God. Not by me, his faith.
Yes. Yes.
I live by the faith of the Son of God who loved me. Who loved me. Say, he loves me.
He loves me.
He loves you with an everlasting love that will never end. He loves you with an everlasting end that will love that will never end. It will never end. He loves you. Problem solved.
Yeah.
Who loved me and gave himself for me. He is drawing you, Jeremiah 33. I'm quoting 31:3. Okay, I have to go look at it because I get the different ones mixed up sometimes, but that's okay. Because he loves me with an everlasting love. Amen. He said, Jeremiah said, I heard the Father say of old, I have loved you with an everlasting love. And I am drawing you with my loving kindness. That sun got up this morning to shine on you. God's saying, I love you. I love you. When you receive that love all the way, when you take this all in, boldness and confidence comes out of you. And you see that he is the glory and the lifter of your head, and your head pops up. Your shoulders go back and you stand because you're victorious. The winning side of a battle never looks defeated. When someone's won a football game, they're not sitting down going. Just a football game. We've won eternal life through Jesus Christ. Eternal life. We won through him. We won through him. He is our victory. It is all in him and nothing of ourselves. He did it all, and he gave it all to you freely. You do not have to earn one thing. Amen. Not one thing do you have to earn in him. He did it. Hallelujah. He finished this work. It's a finished work on Calvary. Amen. And as Ethan reminded me, he didn't only die, Nani, he rose from the dead. I was like, I just got on the die part. He said, but wait. I couldn't even get over to the resurrection. Ethan had to tell me, but he rose from the dead, Nani. I said, yes, he did, victorious. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, hallelujah. I said, you got it. He rose from the dead. It's done. It's finished. He's victorious. And now we are more than conquerors through Christ. Who strengthens us? We are more than conquerors. I tell you what, I've cried out to God. I said, Father, let us get it. Because if we take a hold of this, if we take a hold that we are more than conquerors, if we take a hold of this today, it will change the way we conduct ourselves in you. We will no longer be seated in defeated places, but we will realize that we're seated in heavenly places, that he, when he finished the work, he made us alive. He quickened us by his spirit. He made us alive. And he set us together in Christ Jesus. Not beside him, in him. In Christ Jesus. And from that place of authority. See, I've changed how I pray. From that place of authority, I pray. From that place of authority, I speak. I am seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And that is the place of authority that I have. Do you have it?
Yes.
Then you're going to shine bright. Yes. Hallelujah. You take your place. You take your position in God. He did it. He finished this work for you. It is yours.
Hallelujah.
You're seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. Now pray from that place. Pray from that position.
Amen.
Speak from that position.
Hallelujah.
Let your light shine from that position. I'm in heavenly places, seated in him. That's Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6. So you can write it down, look it up. And read, you know, I told somebody this last week, I said, just sing Jesus Loves Me, This I Know. Jesus Loves Me, This I Know.
Amen.
Because when you get a hold of Jesus Loves Me, This I Know, everything else is going to go away because you're going to be captivated by Jesus Loves Me, 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 me. He's not looking at you going, no, you got some bad brownie points this week, buddy. He's going, I got some things that I'm planning on doing with you, and I'm bringing you over here, and I see you getting more captivated. I see that hunger there. And it may not be a whole huge lot of hunger, but he sees it. He sees it getting bigger and bigger. It might be little to you, and you might be looking at yourself going, I'm kind of lacking. Stop it. See yourself seated in heavenly places.
Amen.
See, if the enemy can defeat the Church of Jesus Christ through trying to take and beat them over the head with what he did in them before they were born again, then he can keep the church defeated. Because if the Church of Jesus Christ gets a hold of the fact that we're seated in heavenly places, that when Jesus finished the work, he finished the work.
Yes.
He finished the work.
Yes.
He said, I give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven.
Yeah.
Ha, 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 ha. I give you, who? His church. I give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth is loosed in heaven. Now you have the power. You have the authority. I'm giving you the keys. I am entrusting you with all that I did.
Hallelujah.
I'm entrusting you. Take it. Take it from there. Take it from there. I'm entrusting you with it. You take it. That's the church. That's the church that Jesus paid for. He says, I'm entrusting you with everything. Now you get busy. You go. You go with all of heaven. You go with all of heaven. I have given you all power and authority. I'm going to read this over here real quick because I won't leave anything out. It's too wonderful. And you, it's in Colossians if you want to turn there with me. Whew, Colossians chapter 1. Oh, the word of God is powerful, quick, sharper than any two-edged sword. And it's going deep down on the inside of every one of us today. And not one of us are going to leave here the same. We're going to leave here seated in heavenly places in Christ Jesus with all power and authority, with the keys of the kingdom. Whatever we bind on earth is going to be bound. Whatever we loose on earth is going to be loose. Because God, when we were dead in our sins and our trespasses, loved us so much that he came. And he allowed his son to be wounded and beat and tormented and tortured to a place that he wasn't even recognizable as a man. He allowed him to take upon the sins of the whole world, that pain, that death, that suffering. He allowed him to take it all on. How many of you having a son would pack him up and send him across the world and say, goodbye, you're going to go die for everybody that's over there? You're getting ready to go die for some people so they can hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. This is the last time we see you. And we're just rejoicing. We're so thankful. We're going to put you on the plane. You're going to go die. Your only son, you only got one. I know, Grace, you just get in there and pack David's bags. Say, bye, David. I'm never going to see you again. You're going to go die. You're going to be beaten. You're going to be brutally treated. They're going to stone you. Guys, the babies aren't bothering me. You don't have to go out. Oh, Jesus. You're going to be tortured. You won't even look like a man when they get done with you. You'll look like some kind of torn up animal. But it's going to change people's lives. Jesus became flesh. He felt the pain. He suffered for the joy that was set before him. He endured the cross. For the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. For the joy, 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 joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. Hallelujah. Despising the shame. Jesus despised the shame. So he could do this for us. Let's start in verse 21. No, let's start in verse 19. For it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. And having made peace through the blood of the cross, by him to reconcile all things unto himself, by him I say, whether they be things in earth or things in heaven, he reconciled all things for you. He reconciled all so we could come say a prayer and say, oh God, forgive me, I want to go to heaven. Amen. Now I'm going to go to heaven and I'm going to live my life. No, Jesus came and he paid that price to reconcile you to the Father, to have relationship with the Father. Not, you know, this is the way that I get to go to heaven. That's not the cross. That's not what it's about. That's nothing to do with what Jesus did. He came to give you eternal life right now. To have fellowship with the Father right now so you can live in days of heaven on earth. People go, oh, when this miserable life is over and I fly away, it's going to be wonderful. No! He came to reconcile you to the Father now. So you could be light in the world. So people could see. A corn of wheat fell. And it went into the ground, and it brought forth much fruit. Me. And then I got crucified with Christ, so that corn fell into the ground. That seed fell into the ground, and it's bringing forth fruit. It's not anything hard to be dead, buried, and raised up together and live eternal life now. In days of heaven on earth, in the realms of glory, in the realms of his presence, it is wonderful. The only hard time or struggle you may have is when you hang on to your life and think that there's something there. Good gracious, let go and you can experience eternity now. Amen. You can experience glory now. Yes. Oh, Jesus. He reconciled us to the Father. Say, he reconciled me to the Father. That is the finished work. The veil of the temple was written too, and he said, come on into the holies of holies. There was never a time from Adam where anyone could go into the holies of holies unless they were this consecrated, set apart, sanctified, dressed a certain way with the right thing on, did the right thing, washed the hands right, looked in the mirror right, killed the animal right, did everything right. You had to do it all right to get in, to go past that veil, to come into that holy place. He tore that thing open and he said, come on in. The blood has done it. Not you, not your ability. Man can't do anything. I've done the work in you. I've done this work in you. I've done this work in you. I've finished this work in you. And you that were sometimes alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now has he reconciled to God the Father. Now has he reconciled in the body of his flesh through death to present you to the Father right now. Have you accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Hey man, I'm not seeing many hands. I want to see the hands. Is Jesus Christ your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
He's reconciled you, and he has presented you to the Father. You are right now holy. You are right now holy.
Yes.
You are holy.
Yes.
You are unblameable.
Yes.
You are unreprovable. Unblameable, unreprovable in his sight. In his sight. And there is the next verse. If you continue, rooted and grounded and settled. We all want to continue. If you continue, rooted and grounded and settled. And the enemy, he tries to slip in right there. Oh, let me go convince them that they're not dead and buried and raised up with Christ, that that old man's not dead. Let me go drag that old nasty, ugly thing up and go, you did this, you did this, you did this, you did this, you did this. As long as you will let the enemy say you did this, you will fall again. But when you say, that's not me, that's not me, that's not me, that's not me, that's dead, buried, and I'm raised up together in Christ Jesus, I walked away from that guy. When you say, that is no longer me, yeah, you nasty looking thing, once you had me in your grip, but my Jesus set me free. Just have revival. When the enemy comes after you with the mess, just have revival. Just have revival. Say, he set me free. Oh, he set me free. Glory to God. He set me free. Once you were captive. Once you were a slave. Once you were bound. Once you were sometimes. You were alienated in enemies, but not anymore. He's made you holy. Jesus answered the devil with the scripture. And you say, yeah, sometimes in the past I was, but through the body of his flesh, he made me holy. He made me holy. He made me unreprovable, unblameable in his sight. Hey, you know what? He sees me in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. He did it. And if you take a hold that that was you and that is not you, the enemy will come out and he'll just like, he'll throw pictures in your mind. He'll, you know, you'll hear words. I mean, it'd be like forceful. Yeah. And you go, yeah, but you're dead. Dead. That was me. It's not me. And that person will become such a stranger to you that you'll, you know, the enemy will come out you after you one day and you'll go, who, what, when, where, what are you? Get out of here. That man's been dead and gone so long, I don't remember him. I tell you what, the goodness of God. I tell you, as you give yourself to God, he'll erase that past from your memory. Just ask him to. He's good. He's a good God. There's nothing he can't do. You don't like the memory of your past? Say, Father, wash it away so much that you erase it. I heard all my life, you're stuck with the memory of the past. You know what? I got the creator of all things. If I ask him to remove the memory of the past, he's good. I'm going to stay the course. Father, remove every memory of sin and powers of Satan that tried to trample over me. I don't want him because I'm ashamed of those things. And I'm in you, and all I want to know is the things of heaven. Yeah. We want to get to know who we are in the new man. Yeah. And forget about who that was over there that you don't even know anymore. When my husband got saved and we got married, he was saved for like 3 years before we got married. People that, you know, family members and people would tell me about his past. I'm like, that ain't him. I don't even want to hear it. I don't know that person. I don't even know that person. I know a man that's seeking after God. I know a man that loves Jesus. Why bring up the past? I don't think you should bring up your past and tell people about it. Just say I was dead in my trespasses and sin, and it was ugly, and it was yucky, but I'm a new man! Old things are passed away. All things are new. Now I'm focusing on who I am. In Christ Jesus. I tell you what, the mercy and the goodness and the love of God, it is so amazing. It is so amazing. I want to turn over to John chapter 17 because, you know, years ago, about nearly 30 years ago, I'd read the book of John and I would just cry and weep. And just look at the heart and the relationship, if you could just see it, that John has with Jesus to this day, it's even deeper. You know, and here's the thing, you know, why people stay stuck where they're at is they haven't received the truth. It doesn't mean that they aren't in God. They've just been stuck over in a deception and a lie of the enemy. They're pursuing after God. I know you're pursuing after God. You're here. You're here. You're pursuing after God. Thank you, Jesus, for every person that sits in these seats, because we have the opportunity to see the Holy Spirit touch them, and this be the day that they get the breakthrough, that they take a hold of the truth, and they're set free, never held in bondage again, but they're set free. Thank you, Jesus. Because the enemy is, he's always trying to put up blinders. But I tell you what, when the truth sets you free, and there's the growing up in truth. You know what? Just to make sure everybody gets that, we're going to look at it real quick. Just one scripture. I mean, we could go to 3 or 4. Man, I'm trying to find where it's at. Oh, here it is. Ephesians 4:15. And it's out of the context in chapter 4 that he gave some apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers for the perfecting of the saints, till we all come in to that perfect man, till we all come to that place of the perfected man. And then I just want to go to verse 15, well, 14, that you be not children tossed to and fro. See, that's what's going on. When you don't have the truth, you're a child tossed to and fro. But when you receive the truth, when that word becomes alive in you, boom, suddenly you go, oh, God, I get it. I get it. I'm no longer that dead man. I have all power and authority to stand against him. He can't force me any longer. People think they're forced. People might even think in the new man that they still want that ugly thing. They might be deceived because it had power over them before, and the enemy just comes and he's so deceiving and so forceful that they might think that they want their old ugly grouchy self, and that grouchy bear's got to pull up again or whatever it is. Because I tell you, the ugly grouchy bear that God hated murmuring and complaining more than he hated as much as he hated anything else. But I mean, it was one that it's a pet peeve with him. He don't like murmuring and complaining. He doesn't like it. There's too much to be thankful for.
Amen. Yes.
Too much to be thankful for. So I don't care if it, you know, let's take homosexuality, because everybody here hates that one. Hates it bad. God hates murmuring and complaining. The same. Well, I mean, you know, sexual sins are more intense. They're damning. But murmuring and complaining get stuck there too. And we go, you know, well, my grandpa, my great-grandpa, my great-great-grandpa was a grouch. Who cares? Jesus set you free from the grouch.
Yes.
But the enemy's forceful. And the enemy will try to tell you it's still your nature. And if you took that into your Christian relationship with Jesus Christ and you didn't get the truth that he doesn't want that there, then today you've got it. And it may be a little bit more challenging for you to say no to it, because you spent the last 10, 20, 30, 40, how many years in your Christian walk with Jesus Christ going, but all of a sudden you go, I'm a new man. God doesn't want me to have that. I don't have to have that. That's the devil lying to me. That's not me. That wasn't because of my great-grandpa. That was because of sin. That's not mine anymore. Truth sets you free. So a little bit more resistance than you had to have when you were a newborn babe. Sometimes the Christians that sat in the church a long time are the ones that are hard to deal with. You know, people get saved, they read their Bible. Jesus said, go into all the world and preach the gospel, heal sick, raise the dead. They go, you know, and 1 year in, they're out there. And the people that were raised in the church are like, but that's okay. Jesus loves you and you're going to get it. Every person in this place is going to get it. I'm praying. I'm praying. I tell you what, this is revival. When we take hold of the word of God and we live it and we walk it out and we know that we're set free and that dead man cannot rise up again in us. And thank you, Jesus, if we sin. Not when we sin, if we sin, but if we sin, 7 times 70 in a day, he'll forgive us. But he didn't give us that scripture he didn't give us that scripture for us to have an excuse to sin. He gave us that scripture to tell us about how great his love was that could be in us, that we could forgive our brother that many times in a day, that we could show forth his love. It's really all about us showing forth his love to our brother 7 times 70 in a day, because that was the context of the subject. Peter says, how many times do I forgive my brother? Or I can't remember what disciple it was right now. But anyway, how many times do I forgive my brother in a day? Jesus said 7 times 70. What is that, 490? Somebody quick with math, 490 times in a day that you're to forgive your brother? But I guarantee you that if you forgive your brother that many times in a day, God will forgive you twice that much in a day. Because he's God, and he can, and he loves you. If we just take a hold of the love of God, we'll stop walking around defeated. We'll stop walking around praying from a defeated attitude, oh me, oh my, oh God, oh, oh. And we'll start going, woohoo! I'm seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. Now I command in Jesus' name that soul be set free. I take my position of authority. And the devil has to stay on the run. Hallelujah. He's not resurrecting his old man in me. Because I'm not that. That was me. I'm not that. That is not me. The enemy comes after you. That is not you. See, that's the deal, is people get convinced that it's them. I still got it. And then they fall into it. And then they fall on their face and they're like, oh God, there's no hope for me. And they start crying. It's good to humble yourself under the mighty hand of God. But look, realize what he's done in you and you won't be overcome. But you'll overcome evil with good. Because that's what's done in you. He did it. Whoever's doing the little flashy can quit. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. He's good. He's good. He's good. He's good. I'm so thankful. So this is it. But speaking, Ephesians 4:15. But speaking the truth in love, may grow up in him in all things, which is the head of Christ. There's the growing up. The truth. When the truth is spoken to you in love. You know, and this works with your children. When you speak to your children in love. You know, fathers, provoke not your children to wrath, but bring them up in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. And that's a whole nother sermon, and I would love to go into that one, but we're not going there right now because that's not the message. But boy, would that be a good trail to go down. He's a loving father. He's called you to be a loving father, and it's training. Don't ever reach out and smack your kid and whack your kid. And more than that, you know, much less with your hand, much more with your mouth. Don't beat your child down. God's not beating you down. He's going, come unto me. Come to daddy. Daddy loves you. And then there's a training. That's the nurture, the training. You know, in Proverbs we see it, my son, get wisdom, get understanding. And we could go on there. The training, they're not born with instructions. That's your job. Slow down and remember what you're doing. You're going to love them to the Father. He gave you the keys and the power and the authority to teach your children the ways of God. And if you do it with the overwhelming love and goodness of God, I tell you what, Father will bless that and he'll shine on it, but he still gave every man upon this earth a will. You know, and kids, until they're grown and off on their own, they may be standing up, sitting down on the outside, but standing up on the inside. But I tell you what, if you do it with love, that love of God sways you. You're so compelled by that love. His love is amazing. When you understand that it's not under the law. See, we try to teach our kids too much under the law. We try to teach people too much under the law. We're under grace, people. And shall we continue in sin because we're under grace? No, God forbid. No, he set you free. Romans 6, 7, and 8 will just blow that up and explode that on the inside of you. You come to know Father in Romans 6, 7, and 8. You come to know the Father in 1 John chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. You come to know that His seed remains in you. When I read that scripture for the first time, that His seed is in me and I cannot sin, I'm like, well, I don't get it. I have sinned. And I've been in I've been in the way a long time. You know, a Christian from a child. And I didn't get it, but I kept reading it and I kept taking it in. His seed is in me and I cannot sin. And the scripture says over here and it says over here, light, revelation, truth coming in. His seed remains in me and I cannot sin. Amen. I'm in Him. When you take a hold of it and you just let it come in and it gets deeper. Oh, it's glorious. It's glorious. Oh, Jesus, it's glorious. Let's go over here to where I was going to start. We got a little bit of time and it probably won't take too long to get through this chapter. But let me start a setting here. For this chapter. Here we are. Can you hear me? Okay, there we go. Here we are. And the disciples, He's just been with them in the to eat the Passover dinner with them. He's just been with them. And He sat at the table with them. And He knew before. He dealt with things before. He knew who Judas was when He took Judas on as one of the disciples. And isn't it amazing how He gave Judas, of all people, He knew He was. He knew He was a thief from the beginning, and He gave Judas the money to carry. And that's what that was the thing that Judas held on to was the money. And, Judas probably figured, I'll go get this 30 pieces of silver, I'll hand over Jesus, and I've seen Him do all these miracles, I've seen Him slip through the crowd, and He'll slip right through them, and then we'll have more money in the bag. We'll be richer. Got a plan. More money, how to get it. We're going to get those scribes and Pharisees, and we're going to get their money, and we're going to be looking good, because I've been really saving it up here, and really watching how much we give to the poor. Jesus gets the bag and He's like, because He's the supply. But Judas didn't get that. He thought He was the supply. Ooh, money can really get you. Okay, enough of that. Anyway, that could be a long sermon. Cares, riches, and pleasures. Oh, but God's good. He loves us. And I tell you what, people, there was only one Judas. So many people are, if you would count the people that think they're Judas. Because the devil wants to try to steal from you what God did and keep you a handicapped Christian. I shouldn't do any of that. But, I don't want to make fun of anybody. But wants to keep you just, no arms, no legs, no feet, no mouth, no moving, handicapped. We ain't going to be that way because we're alive in Him. We're taking the truth on the inside of us and we're going to live the truth.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. Oh, He's good. So anyway, he's got Peter there and He's got the other disciples and He says, every one of you are going to leave me. Shepherd's going to be smitten and He's going to be left alone. Jesus knew He had to do this by Himself, that these guys that He trained for 3 years and He gave them power and authority to cast out devils, to heal the sick. They saw the glory of heaven. Hey, Peter, James, and John were all three there at the Mount of Transfiguration. They saw the glory of heaven. They saw Jesus in that glory. Talking to Moses and Elijah. They saw it. And He knew they were going to run like chickens. When He was caught. I mean, they didn't even get to a place where they saw Jesus starting to get beaten before they took off. And then He says to Peter, Peter, Satan has desired to sift you. but I prayed for you. And Peter's like, I'll die with you. Come on, where's the swords? Let's get them. Let's get ready for battle. Because, you know, he was thinking like in the Old Testament, in Gideon's army, there were only 300 men and there were thousands of the enemy. You know, it was probably, 30,000 to one. And God fought the battle for him and they won. So, you know, Peter's like, come on, let's take them on. And, you know, Peter didn't get it the whole time, you know. They wanted to call fire down out of heaven. So anyway, so this is what Jesus has after 3 years of pouring into them and giving them power like we ain't never seen on earth today. Everywhere they went, they healed the sick, they raised the dead, they cast out devils. I mean, they operated in the power. They saw the glory of heaven. They saw Jesus in that place of glory. And they're all going to leave him. And then he says, Peter, you're going to deny me 3 times before the sun comes up. He didn't say it like that. He said, Peter, you're going to deny me 3 times before the sun comes up. But I love you so much. I prayed for you, Peter. And when you're converted, I want you to go and preach. The moment you realize what you've done, that moment, I want you to go and preach. That's the God we serve. He didn't say, I want you to take out a year and wait. He says, I want you to go and preach. Woo, hallelujah. There isn't any reason for anybody to be defeated. Because Peter denied him and even cursed. Said, I don't know the man. I don't know him. And began to curse and try to really frame himself up as a person that had nothing to do with the master. And Jesus said, as soon as you get this all straightened out, I prayed for you. Go preach. This is what Jesus is dealing with. And then this is what he said to his disciples, that he prayed with his disciples. He prayed this prayer with his disciples with them hearing. He said, oh my goodness, Jesus. These words spake Jesus and lifted up his eyes to heaven. With them, he's with them. Father, the hour is come. Glorify your Son, that your Son may be glorified in thee. As you have given him power over all flesh, power and authority over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as you've given him. And this is eternal life, that they might know you. See, what did I tell you? Not so we could die and go to heaven, but that we might know him and live in days of heaven on earth here. That they might know you and the glory. Huh. It's the time in the fellowship that we spend with Father that is so glorious that we brought back into that union. See, the whole reason that Peter denied Jesus is Jesus explained it to him. He told him in the garden. He said, can't you watch with me for an hour? He said, watch and pray or you'll enter into temptation. Have you been entering into temptation? Well, Jesus gave you the key. If you'll take this truth today, write it down, put it up on your wall, watch and pray that you enter not into temptation. You spend time in the presence of the Father, you caught up in the realm of His glory, you're not going to enter into temptation. You're going to finish the work He's given you to do. He's done it all in you. It is yours. And for it to multiply and work and function in you, you've got to take a hold of the truth of the Word and say, this is who I am. Now I'm going to watch and pray. And I'm going to live in this glory. I'm going to give myself to this glorious Word that's life eternal. It's spirit and life. Oh, Jesus. I would that all we had to do was just sit and meditate upon the Word because it explodes. Every time we go through the Word, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger and brighter. I mean, I said, you know, the Word of God is simple to understand, but it's not simple. It's complex because it's eternal. But it's not complex. It's simple. But it's so eternal that the revelation never ends. So therefore, in a sense, it's complex, but it's not as simple for you to receive. Isn't that amazing? But that's God. It's very simple. But it's eternal. So it's vast. And it's never ending. So every time you read the word, it explodes bigger and brighter. It gets to be more. Oh, Jesus. Hey, so good. Woo! Hallelujah. How can we be anything more than victorious when we receive the truth? If you will bathe yourself in the word and watch and pray, you got it. Bathe yourself in the word, watch and pray, and know that you're a new man and Jesus has finished the work and he's done it all for you. And that old thing is not you. It is not you. Notify the enemy every time he comes on, because I don't care if you're the greatest preacher on the planet, and that's probably the ones that get the most. If you're the greatest preacher on the planet, you've got the most miracles, you've got the most people in your meetings, and you see the most of the kingdom of heaven coming down, the enemy's going to come and bring the pictures and bring the words and bring the thoughts and bring the da-da-da, and he's going to wah on his loudspeaker. That's not me. That's the enemy. Aware of the devices of the enemy. Shh. You take the truth sets you free. Take the truth. Eat it, eat it, eat it, eat it, eat it, eat it. Come on, take it. Take it, grab it today. Grab it today. Take it, eat it. Take it down. Let it become your DNA. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. And this is eternal life, that they might know you, the only true God in Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. This is why Jesus died. And I have glorified you on the earth. I finished the work. I finished the work. And the finished work of Calvary is right ahead, but it's already done. Jesus said, it's done. I'm doing it. It's done. I mean, to Jesus, it was finished. He's already crucified, buried, and raised up. I finished the work that you've given me to do. And now, O Father, glorify me with your own self, with the glory which I had with you before the world was. I have manifested. I have revealed. I have been the proof provider. Joseph Deskins preached a message probably 10 years ago on the proof provider. Jesus Christ, the proof provider. And I have never forgotten that message. That thing just went on the inside of me, the proof provider. I'm like, he's the proof provider. And I started looking at the proof provider. And I started taking in the proof provider. And he's made us proof providers. He wants us to manifest him. He wants us to manifest him. Jesus Christ came and he revealed the Father to man. How did he reveal the Father? Let me tell you how he revealed the Father. He not only healed all the sick that came to him, but there's a funeral procession going by. And we could go on and on and on about these stories. There's a funeral procession going by. And he, in his spirit, that compassion and that love of God, he doesn't know this woman. He doesn't know this son. As a man would know people. But there's a funeral procession going by. And he, out of the compassion of the Father, hears, I love that woman, and that's her only son. Get him up. And he goes over there and he stops it and he goes, get up. Get up. This is how he revealed God, his love. His love. His love. That woman needs that boy. Get him up. His love. You know, people have God with a stick beating you up, going, go do this and get out there and you better straighten up. And so people carry around sticks. And I saw the other night, Wednesday night, a week and a half ago, I saw where, you know, the Lord was saying, bring your sticks, bring your clubs. You know how people bring their wheelchairs and they bring their walkers when they get healed. Jesus wants to heal your insides because he didn't give you a club. He didn't give you a stick. He gave you his love. He gave you his love. He loves you. He didn't give you something to beat yourself up. And the Lord wants to set you free from your stick. He wants to set you free from that club that the enemy put in your hand. And I just saw a pile of sticks in the front, a pile of clubs of where people beat themselves up continually and say, I'm a loser. You may not say it out loud, but in your spirit, again and again, you beat yourself up. And God's saying, I love you. God's saying, I love you with an everlasting love. I'm drawing you with my loving kindness. Don't look to you, look to me. Look to Jesus, the author and the finisher of your faith. Look to Jesus. Stop looking to you. It's not your work, it's his. It's his work in you. Oh, the love of God. Oh, the love of God. Oh, the love of God. And here Jesus is telling this. This is going to his disciples. Just right here. The ones that are getting ready to leave him all alone, to let him suffer alone, and to deny his name and to curse him. I have manifested thy name unto the men which you've given me. He's talking about the 12 that are getting ready to leave him. I've manifested thy name unto the men that you've given him. He was talking about the 70 others. He was talking about the many others that aren't even included in the 12 and the 70. I've manifested myself. I've manifested myself to all of Israel. He's talking about him, and not one was going to stand up for him. He said, I've manifested myself to them, which you gave me out of this world. They're yours, thine they were, and you gave them to me, and I have kept them. I have kept them. And they have kept thy word. And they have kept thy word. And now, they have known that all things, whatever you have given me, are of you. And I have given unto them the words which you gave me. They have received them. I'm talking about Peter that's going to deny him three times. Peter's received them. But yet, he's going to deny him. He's going to curse him. Peter's received your words, Lord. They're going to all walk away from me. They're going to run. But they've received your words, Lord. They'll come back. They'll get it. Because they've received your word. Which you gave me. And have known surely that I have come from you. And they have believed that you sent me. See, that was their heart. Jesus wasn't going to look at their human ability and their reaction at the moment. He wasn't looking at that. He knew they were going to do it, but he prayed for them. I want to tell you, people, he sits at the right hand of the Father, interceding for us. And guess what? We're sitting with him in him. Hallelujah. Oh, the glory. The glory, the love that goes far beyond what man can comprehend. Man can't comprehend this love, but God has put it in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, and we'll just yield to it. If we'll just yield to it. I tell you what, as I was reading this the other day, I just cried the entire time I was reading John chapter 17. I just cried. I said, oh God, the people that were going to deny you, the people that were going to run from you, and look at this. Look at what you're saying to them. And you weren't only praying this prayer for those that were going to, everyone that were going to run from you and leave you alone and deny you and not be there in your most critical hour. You were praying it for me today. The love of God. Everybody is so, every person on this planet is so important to God that he sent his son to die for them. If they will be as important to us as those that have been commissioned to go to them. As they are to God. There isn't one person that you won't fall on your face and cry and weep for. There isn't one person that you will reject ever, no matter what. You will continue to cry and to weep for them and to call them into the kingdom. You will show them the love of God. Those that it looks critical for them, you will go the extra mile. You will step beyond. And you will love on them. If you just take a hold of the love that he has for every one of us, for me. You know, before we can love them, we've got to realize how much he loves us. We've got to be captivated by this love that he has for us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's so good. It's so glorious. I pray for them. I pray not for the world, but for them which you've given me, for they are yours. And all of mine are thine, and yours are mine, and I'm glorified in them. These rotten, low-down losers that are going to leave me. No, he didn't say that, but we would. Like I was teaching John Lucas scripture the other day. It was, I taught it to him, and now I got to remember, John 15:12, I believe. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. And we were going over it, and I'm saying to John Luke, I said, okay, now say it back to Nani. This is my commandment, that you love as other people love you. I said, yeah, that's exactly what we do. If people love me enough, I'll let them in my circle. I'll let them in my sphere. If they do it right, and they love me, and they really show they love me, they better show they love me if they want to get in on my side. No, this is truth. Come on, it's right here in this place. I'm sorry, but I'm just, you know, God loves us right where we're at, and he's going, come over here. And he gives some pats in the right place. No, he draws us with his word. He says, look over here, come visit with this right here, look right there. I want to explode it on the inside of you. And once you get this. And I said, I had to laugh. I stopped and I just had to laugh. I go, now let's go over that again. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. Not as people love you. You don't love them when, but you know what? Nobody's going to love God till he loves them first. And we're the love of God manifested to the earth. He gave it to us. He entrusted us with the kingdom. And he said, here it is. Take it. I'm leaving you. I'm going up to heaven. I'm sitting at the right hand of the Father. I'm sending the Holy Ghost. And he's going to work through you. You can't see him, but he's going to be in you. And he's going to do the work through you. I entrusted you with it. What are we doing with what he entrusted us with? Let's go on. That's just a little side note. But you know what? You get a hold of the love of God and you'll be doing what he's entrusted you with in a greater way. But right now, God's going, come over here. And now I'm no more in the world, but these are in the world, because I'm out of here. Look at how he's talking. I'm no more in the world. It's done. It's finished. But these are in the world. And I come to you, Holy Father, keep through your own name those whom you've given me, that they may be one as we are one. We would say, if they love me right, keep through. And it is a fact. If you love me, you're going to keep my commandments. But you know what? We can't love him until we realize that he's loved us first. Because it comes out of that. Because God is love, and every bit of love that anyone has is real love. It comes from God. It's not this love that's in the world, and God forbid in the church, but it's in the church because people don't know the love of God, of where they marry somebody one day, and then in a couple of years, they go, I don't love them anymore. Well, you never loved them in the first place. You loved gratifying yourself. You loved what it was going to bring to you. Because love is how can I serve and lay down my life. See, till we understand the love of God, we're not going to get up in the morning and deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him. But when we understand how much he loves us, we get up in the morning going, God, I want all of you. And Lord Jesus, what are you doing today? Not me. And that cross is going to be on us and we're going. Ha, hallelujah. That love. See, people don't receive the love of God because they don't know it's there, because nobody really loved on them in their ugliness. Have you ever loved an obnoxious person over to the place? Somebody that rejected you and was rude to you and was mean to you. Have you ever loved them over into the kingdom and loved them over into fellowship and friendship and closeness to you? You can't look at what they're doing. You can't look at the hurt. There's those people, because this is all they know, because this is the world. They'll lash out at you. And it's the world in the church too. And they'll lash out at you, but you love them anyway. Because God's in you. And you reach out to him anyway. And you hug him anyway. And you bless him anyway. And you're good to him anyway. Because you know that God has purposes for them. You know how much God loves them. And God's going to bring them from where they're at over here when they take a hold of the love of God. You don't look at where they're at. You look at what God's done for them. And what God's going to do in them. If you want revelation knowledge, get this kind of revelation. the worst rotten-looking person you can find. God, what are you doing in them, and what is your purpose, and what is your plan? Reveal it to me so I can start speaking life into them, so I can see that ugly thing turn into something glorious and beautiful because of the love of God. People don't even love their children that way. They love their children to gratify themselves, and then when they're in their way, they're like smacking them or they're tongue-talking them down, abusing them with their mouth. Jesus, help us. Oh, hallelujah. If we just get a hold of who God is, we'll never go back. If you receive the truth, the lie has to get out, and you can live in the truth, and the lie has no more domination over you. Woo-hoo! Hallelujah. While I was with them in the world, I kept them. In thy name, those that you gave me, I kept, and none of them are lost but the son of perdition, that scripture might be fulfilled. None of them are lost. Peter's going to deny him. 3 times he's going to curse. They're going to all run, but none of them are lost. That's how we need to save people. With the love of God, the potential and the purpose of God that God has for them. This is how you know that you are his disciple, by the love that you have one for another. Glory. This is good. And now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world, that they might have my joy fulfilled in themselves. I'm just crying the whole time I'm reading this the other day. And the only reason I'm standing up here not losing it is because I'm supposed to allow the Holy Spirit to impart this in you, so you can take a hold of how much God loves you, and you can come and you can bring your club and throw it at the altar and never pick that ugly thing up again. So you can live victorious in Jesus Christ. So you can come into that place of his love for you. So you can say to that ugly person when he tries to come, and the enemy when he comes tries to come against you with the old man, and you can say, that's not me. I'm seated with him in heavenly places. I'm in Christ Jesus, and he's in me. Because he prayed for me that I could be one in him as he is in the Father, that I could be in them. And that's who I am. And I'm not letting anything take this treasure from me. And then you'll see the pearl of great price, and you'll go and sell everything you have to obtain that pearl, and your cross won't be anything, because it'll be a love servant to take a cross with joy, with the joy fulfilled in them. Glory to the name of Jesus. I tell you what, when the enemy comes against you and you tell him that's no longer you, you black both of his eyes. You kick him in the pants and you put him on the run, because you know what? He can't come across the blood, and the blood's over you. You're the only one that can step on the other side. But if you realize that it's only you that can step on the other side, you won't step across the blood. You won't do it anymore. The enemy won't convince you that that's you anymore. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. That's not me anymore. I'm not having it anymore. Get out of here. In Jesus' name. Whoo! Glory. Look what the Lord has done. Oh, hallelujah. He's done it. It's finished in me. Is it finished in you? I tell you what, if it's finished in you, you're going to get happy. You're going to live happy. You're going to have a smile on your face, and that glory glow of God is going to be on you. You're not going to come weeping in the morning. Hallelujah. But you're going to come standing in the finished work of Calvary. The finished work. Hallelujah. He's the glory and the lifter of your head when you take the truth. I was going to just try to read this and then go back and expound on a little bit, but let's see. Let's go ahead here. Where am I at? I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Comprehend that with the 12 disciples that are getting ready to leave him. Nobody's standing with him. I know I keep going back to this, and I know you're very bright people and you get it. But do we get it? Maybe if we're repetitive in Revelation, we will get it. Even as I am not of the world, they are not of the world. Even as I'm not of the world, they are not of the world. Even as I'm not of the world, you are not of the world. Even as he is not of the world. We are not of the world. Even as he is not of the world, we're not of the world. It's time. It's time. I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them from the evil. Ha! Done, finished. Jesus prayed that we're kept from the evil. So the evil can't come. It's a lie. It's not the truth. The truth is I'm kept. Take the truth. Grab it. Eat it up.
Amen.
Take it. Take the truth. Ha! Thank you, Jesus. Jesus prayed that I'm kept from the evil, so therefore I'm kept from you. Ha! Bloodline. It's painted over me. In Egypt, everybody that put the blood on their doorpost, the death had to pass by. The enemy has to pass by where the blood is. Is the blood on you? Is the blood on you? Stop looking to you and look to him. I pray not that you should take them out of the world, but that you should keep them in the world. They are not of the world, even as I'm not of the world. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Right there. Right there it comes to say, thy word is truth. Set them apart, sanctified, separate, dedicated, consecrated. Separate them, even as you've separated me. Separate them unto you. And they'll grow in the word, and they'll grow in the truth. They'll grow up in it. John, you're growing up in this truth. You're taking the truth. And when you take in the truth, it sets you free. You know, we could go out there and we could start casting demons out of people, left and right. But if they don't have the truth, when the house is emptied, they'll go and get 10 more wicked than themselves, and they'll come back, and the last state of that man will be worse than the first. But I tell you what, when you take in the truth, every bondage that ever held itself over you is defeated. It goes. It has to leave. At that moment that you receive the truth, the power of darkness that tried to blind you leaves. That's why I'm saying take it and eat it up. Jesus, I'm having a good breakfast, lunch, and supper here myself, and snacks in between. Ha! Ah, thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. As you have sent me into the world, even so I send them. And while they're growing in this truth and the word, I've completed and finished the work, and now I send them to do my work. To carry on what I started. He handed it to you, every one of you. Every person in this place without exception. He gave it to you, every person in this place without exception. When you see that, that is absolutely amazing. Lawrence, God said, here, Lawrence. You're separated and sanctified and set apart. And I give you the keys to the kingdom. I give you power and authority. Continue on my work. I'm leaving. I'm going to the Father. I'll send the Holy Ghost and he'll be in you. Now you go on. Shine bright because I've given you the light. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't his word empowering? It's explosive. You know, if we'd look at that as God told me to carry on, like there was nobody left, nobody but me to carry on, and every one of us took it and said, I have this responsibility to carry on what Jesus started here on earth. And it's mine to carry on. I mean, I think we would get up and start going more than we go. But we can only do that in the revelation of the love of what he's done, and it's a finished work, and it is ours. So receive this. Thank you, Jesus. And for their sakes, I set apart myself. I sanctify myself that they might also be sanctified through the truth. The love of God. Neither pray I these for them alone, pray for these alone, but for them also that shall believe on me through their word. Are you one of those people that believed on him through their word? It may be handed down for generations, but Jesus prayed for you before he went to the cross. He prayed for you. That's powerful, people. That means he knows that we believed upon his name. And he doesn't want us to look to ourselves anymore, but he just wants us to take on that authority and take those keys. And whatever we bind on earth, bound in heaven. He did say, go wait for the promise. And you'll be a dude with power and then go. But he said, here you go. Be like me. Manifest myself to the world. Wherever you go. Praise you, Jesus. That they all may be one. You know, there's three verses that he talks about being one. In here, but five times in this one chapter, he says that we may be in the Father, that they may be one as we are one. It only takes three verses to form a doctrine and to know that it is said. And Jesus said it over and over in one chapter, that we're in him and he's in us. We're in the Father and he's in us. Amen. Do we comprehend what glory and what position that is in? That is. That position is we have all power and authority. We're seated in the heavenly places to do his work, just like he did. If we believe it, we can do it. If we believe it, we can live it out. If we believe it, we can manifest it like he did.
Amen.
We only have to take it and believe it. That's it. And do it like he did with that love. And I will say that is why there is not greater works than these today, is because people don't take a hold of the love of God. They don't take a hold of how God sees things. They deal with things by men's ability and men's understanding, and not the love of God that reaches down, that great goodness of God. Man, that takes me to so many scriptures. We could stay here all afternoon, but I'll stay here. That they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me and I'm in you. That they may be one in us. Look, people, you don't ever have to be accepted by any man, woman, boy, or girl ever on this earth. Again, the world's going to hate you. Don't worry about it. People in the church aren't going to like you. Don't worry about it. You're in him and he's in you. You're accepted. You've got all the acceptance you need. You never have to bend, bow, or cower. Because he's in you and you're in him. You have all the acceptance of heaven. Why ever be defeated? Why ever be cast down? Why ever pull out that ugly club and beat yourself again? Bring that club to the cross. Lay it down. We're going to have a victory service here. We're going to see people set free. That they all may be one. As you, Father, are in me and I'm in you, that they all may be one in us, that the world may believe that you have sent me. Because they're one in me. And now the world's going to know it. Because I send them. And the glory which you've given me. And the glory which you have given me. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo. And the glory which you have given me, I have given to them. That they may be one even as we are one.
Yes, Lord.
Now we don't get it. We don't get it. There is nothing impossible to us. Because he gave it to us. Brittany, you don't have to earn it. It's yours.
Now, one person, look to yourself ever again. Look to Jesus. He's the beginning and the end. He's the author and the finisher of your faith. He authored it. He will finish it. Look to Him. As long as you keep your eyes on Him, you have all of this. It's yours. Thank you, Jesus. I in them. He said it over and over again. I in them. You in me. That they may be made perfect in one, in this oneness, in this unity, in this fellowship, in this relationship. And that the world may know that you have sent me. Because they're going to be just like me. Because they're in me and I'm in them. Jesus. And as love them as you have loved me. With the same love that God loved His only begotten Son. He loves us. He doesn't love us any different than He loves His Son. I was thinking about that. How much I love my sons. And my grandsons. I have 7 grandsons and 2 sons. 3 sons. I have 3 sons, 7 grandsons, 3 daughters, and 3 granddaughters. And I was thinking, oh, Jesus, you love me just as much as you loved your son. I'm like, oh, God, I want to love other people like I love my kids. I'm like, Lord, I don't think I can say that. I love my kids so much. I would do anything for them. I would die for them. I would die. I would jump and I would take the bullet. If I knew somebody was coming to shoot them, I would jump out in front of that bullet. I would take it. I love my kids. I don't think that there's people that can love their kids any more than I love my kids. You may love your kids as much, but you can't love them more than I love my kids. I love my kids. I love my grandbabies. They are the treasures His Father's given to me, and I fought so many battles pointing them to the kingdom of heaven. My greatest desire for every one of them is not riches and pleasures and things on this earth, but it's that they might know Him. That they might know Him. But I said the other day, and this is why I'm crying, I said the other day, God, I just want to love everybody as much as I love my children because You did. I want to see that, Father. I want to see that like You see that. Because that's amazing love. And He loved me that way. And He gave me the Holy Ghost and enabled me to do that. So I want to. I just yield myself to that. Jesus. I could just, you know, go and cry for a little bit right now. Because, I mean, you know, when Father touches you deep, sometimes you kind of almost collapse and you're like, you can't hardly move. People might call it drunk in the spirit, but I won't reduce it to such a low position of deprived humanity, of the counterfeit of what Satan brought to try to counterfeit men into a place that God has that's so glorious that doesn't have any throwing up to it. That only has the ecstasy of heaven and the glory of heaven with it. You know, the glory. You know, I wanted to finish my sermon Wednesday night a week and a half ago. But, you know, the glory came and I knew people's lives were being touched. And the what came back from that is people were so touched by the glory of God that they were just lifted into that place of glory that God touched them. That they were incapacitated. They were not themselves. And I'm kind of like feeling it coming on right now in such a way that Jesus, oh, but you know when God touches you, you know when He touches you is because you know you just go and you look at His word and you're like, God, I want that. I want to be like You, Jesus. You've done so much for me, Lord. It's nothing that I just give my everything for You. Because look what You've done for me. You touched me. You brought me back into relationship with the Father. And Lord, this glory, this communion with the Father is so glorious. Lord Jesus, You just rapture me all the time in this fellowship. Father, You talk to me. Father, I talk to you, and when you talk to me, Father, you talk to me, and you fill me, Lord, with just such peace and such glory and such love. Lord, you never beat me up. Lord, you just come to me, and you just love on me. He might stop me and steal me when I'm doing something so I can recognize that I'm, like, getting out of line. And then I'm just like, oh, yeah, Father, okay, but stop, don't move. And then just get right back over into the glory. Jesus. Oh, Lord. Woo. Jesus. If you can, just taste and see how good he is. Just taste and see how good he is. Let him touch you. Let him touch you deep down on the inside. Oh. Just come to know him and his goodness. Just look and see what he's done for you. Oh, just let him ravish you. Oh, into this glory. Listen, Father, I will that they also whom you have given me be with me where I am. He prayed that we could be with him where he's at, and we can. We can. It's not just when we die and go to heaven, but it's right now in this moment, in this place, that we can be with him over in this realm of his glory, over in this realm of his presence. He just says, come. Right where you're at, you don't have to even move. He just says, come to this place to receive. He says, Father, they may be where I'm at. And Jesus is in all the glory of the Father, in case you don't know. Oh, I want more. I know we go from glory to glory, and we only see darkly through his throat, through a glass, but then we shall see face to face. But I will tell you this glory that I'm seeing right now. The glory. Oh, Jesus, the glory. Oh, the glory. Whew. That they may behold the glory. That's the purpose. That's the purpose that Jesus died. That we can behold the glory of the Father. That we can be brought back into unity with him. Oh, just bear with me. Just bear with me. Because he wants us to have that glory. He's given it to you. And he wants you to have this. And it's so good. And he doesn't want you to just have it on Sunday morning. And on Sunday night. And on Wednesday night. And if you come to youth on Thursday. And on Friday night. But he wants this to be how you live day in, day out. He wants you to spend the night with him and get up in the glory with him and to live your life in the glory of the Father. Oh, this is too much for one person to take at one time. It's too glorious. It's too good. It's too explosive. And Father wants you to have it. He don't want one person in his room to be left out. Oh, he says, don't labor anymore. He says, come to me, all you that are heavy laden. If you're heavy laden, he says, come to the glory. Oh, this glory. He says, come over to the glory. Jesus. Oh. Over to the glory which you've given me. And we know he has all the glory of the Father. We already said that, didn't we? For you loved me before the foundations of the world. And he just said up there. Didn't he just say up there that you love them as you've loved me? I think I'm getting more revelation. Y'all just bear with me. what he's given us. Pai suneki shipalubai ke tu kan suba. Koi shimali pie chele. Kai de buna kai ziklemi ushai. Hai chela. Yule bushina kseli mincho. Nai kishi pe. Sublelo butufa. Hai kelmi. Sukushin. Sumandi limonchi. Father says, come drink of the water freely. I give you this water of life, and it will be springing up in you. It will spring up in you. It will spring up in you. Everlasting water of life will spring up in you. Oh, hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus. Lord Jesus. So bien, so cool, Maroche. Oh, Jesus. All the Father has, He freely gives to you right now. He freely gives. He freely gives. Jesus. He freely gives to us so we can live this out every day, every moment of the day, that this is our life, this is the way we are, and this is who we are. Whew. Jesus. Oh, thank you, Father. Oh, righteous Father, the world has not known you, but I have known you. And these right here, they've known you. They've known that you've sent me. And I have declared, revealed unto them thy name, and will declare it, that the love wherewith you have loved me may be in them and I in them. Jesus. Jesus. People. He has given you His love, and He loves you so much you never have to be defeated another day. But if you don't get it now, He'll woo you with His loving kindness, and He won't give up on you because He loves you. That's a love we don't comprehend because we give up and we break relationship all the time and we walk away from people, but God will never stop. He will never break relationship. He will never turn from you. He will never leave you or forsake you. He will never leave you or forsake you. David said, though I make my bed in hell, Lord, you are there. Yes. You are drawing me. Oh, Father. I usually only rapture like this over there while I'm sitting. But whatever, have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. We've got to stop telling the potter what to do and just be the clay. Yes. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Father, I just thank you that you move by your Spirit and you breathe on us right now. You breathe on every person in this place right now. Father, we thank you for the wind of heaven. We thank you for the moving of your Spirit. Holy Spirit, breathe on every person in this place.
Yes, Lord.
Breathe on us, oh God. Breathe on us, oh God. Breathe on us the breath of life, and may we never be the same. May we never be the same, in Jesus' name. Oh, Lord Jesus, if there's anybody in this place that you want prayer, we'll be glad to pray for you. If there's anybody in this place that wants to come and worship the Lord with the righteousness that He's increased you with, that you may increase your righteousness, we're glad for you to come and worship the Lord. And we just want to see every person touched by the realm of His glory. So you can either whatever. Stay caught up in the realms of His glory. Come and worship the Lord. Because that's caught up in the realms of His glory with what you have. And if you need prayer, I tell you, we'll pray for you. But I tell you what, we can lay hands on you all day, and every man of God that's on this planet can lay hands on you all day, and they can impart what they have. But if you don't receive the truth that expels the lie and sets you free, it's not going to change anything until you receive it. If you receive it, the change comes.